Thank you, Andy. I hope you can hear me well. Excellent. So, my name is Antonio Bertoletti. I'm working at the Emerging Infectious Disease in Singapore. Let me see if I can move the slides, which is quite important. Yes, this is my group. And I just want to say that, I mean, my group is really a group of immunologists that have always studied T cell response, but against hepatitis B virus. So, I mean, my expertise is really on hepatitis B, particularly on T cell response against hepatitis B. But again, from basically March, we start to study SARS-CoV-2 specific T cells, and this is what I'm going to present you. I just also want to acknowledge the collaboration with the many hospitals in Singapore that provide us different samples. So, as I told you again, my main interest has always been in virus-specific CD8 and CD4 T cells. I don't think I have to go really in the details. I suppose everybody knows what is the importance of these two components of the adaptive immunity, that with antibodies are really the let's say, our weapons against the virus. But just to briefly say, CD8 T cells are important because they recognize directly virus-infected cells, and they lyse them or they produce cytokines able to inhibit viral replication. Then we have CD4 T cells. CD4 T cells are recognizing still viral antigen, but they recognize viral antigen in association with HLA class II. And in this case, the viral antigen is not endogenously synthesized like in virus-infected cell, but is picking up from the exterior. And so, therefore, basically, antigen-presenting cells are picking up viral antigen that is circulating, for example, and are presenting to CD4 T cells. And CD4 T cells are important because they are important for the maturation of the cell, for the clonal expansion of the CD8, and I would say in SARS-CoV-2, there have been animal models that have shown that CD4 T cells can also be very important for the control of infection. So why study T cells in coronavirus infection? So basically, when in February, March, we start to study, we immediately see that there were very good animal models already that have demonstrated that actually CD4 and CD8 T cells are extremely important for the control of the virus. And therefore, again, we started really to work on this. We have, I would say, immediately tried to understand whether SARS-CoV-2 T cells were actually induced in COVID-19 patients. We have done a work this spring and in summer, where we investigate the presence of T cells in COVID-19 patients, in healthy individuals, and also in SARS convalescent. I'm working in Singapore, and therefore, I mean, we were able to obtain samples from SARS patients that got infection 17 years ago, demonstrated that actually they were memory T cells. And then now, instead, I'm going to show you basically other new data unpublished, which are, again, looking mainly at the kinetics of SARS-CoV-2 T cells in acute patients. And if I have time, I will briefly also show you some data about SARS-CoV-2 T cells in completely asymptomatic subjects. Here I try to summarize what we know about T cells. There are many, many papers now that are showing that SARS-CoV-2 T cells specific for different viral antigen, viral proteins, are actually induced during the infection in the convalescent phase. Very little is known about what's happening during the acute phase of the disease, when the virus is still present and is still replicating. Until, I would say, a couple of weeks ago, maybe not even a couple of weeks, until basically 3 days ago, we didn't know anything about memory T cells in SARS-CoV-2. Now we start to have some papers from the SETE group, from a group also in Birmingham, and now I saw just couple of hours ago, another group in China that I showed that actually we can have memory T cells. But in any case, what I'm going to focus today is here, the early phase of the response. Briefly, the methods that we are using to study T cells It's a simple method. We are basically, at the moment, only working on peripheral blood mononuclear cells, so we are not really looking at the T cells at the site of the infection, but we are looking in the blood. And we are using peptides of that are covering the different proteins. We just use overlapping peptides, and we don't use any selection with algorithms. And then we are doing simple assay, pretty much an ELISpot spot assay, just to see the number of cells that are producing gamma interferon. And then we go a little bit deep if we want to analyze the phenotype of the cells, what they are, CD4, CD8, and their phenotype with flow cytometry. I just want to remind you that again, like the previous speaker said, I mean, the SARS-CoV-2 is really a big virus. It has a large proteome. It's about 10,000 amino acids. So it's difficult to study all the T cell potentially specific for all the different proteins that the virus is synthesizing for his replication. So at the moment, we have studied mainly structural proteins, nucleoprotein, membrane, but also some other proteins like ORF7-8, ORF8, ORF3A, that are sort of structural proteins, but also regulatory proteins. And then we have started to analyze the non-structural protein that are coded by the ORF1 genes. That I think is going to be a very important step on our understanding of the T cell response, but they are still under study. We started to study something, just looking at NSP7 and NSP13. Why we are not basically studying everything? Well, it's a question really of quantity of cell, quantity of peptides. Most of the time, we don't basically are able to obtain so much blood from patients that we'll be able to really analyze all the different T cell response specific for all the different proteins. Okay, what we have done, the data that I show you is basically an analysis of the dynamic changes of virological and immunological parameters that are present in 12 patients, few patients, not many, but we study them several times during the acute phase and at convalescent. 8 have mild symptoms and 4 are moderate severe symptoms. What does it mean? Mild symptom means basically just presence of fever or just mild respiratory symptoms, basically cough. And instead, the moderate and the severe cases where patients that require oxygen supplementation. Just want to stress that unfortunately one of the patients that we have studied actually died from the disease. And what we have done was to quantify the viral load based on the number of PCR cycle. We have studied also the antibody with two different methods. One, we basically study the antibodies that are specific for the spike protein and that antibody that are blocking the interaction between the spike protein and the ACE2 receptor. It's an assay that we call surrogate virus neutralizing assay. And then we study the antibody response against the nucleoprotein or spike protein using Luminex, so basically coating beads with the antigen and analyzing the binding of the antibody to these beads. And then we study T cells, as I said to you before, against structural and non-structural proteins. Results. So these are the first results. These are basically the 12 patients that we study longitudinally. The line represents the time that the patients were positive. And this is basically our patients that in this part of the slides, they were infected no more than 15 days here, you can see, and they became basically negative at around 10, 12 days after infection. The dots represent the quantity of virus. Here they are the patients again, that they are instead longer infection. And the green, the orange, and the red represent again the mild, the patients with mild symptoms, and the orange and the red represent the patients with moderate and severe. And you can see this was the patients that actually never clear the infection and die after basically 40 days of disease. And what we found was very simple in one way, and something that somehow we know already. The subjects that have higher level of viral replication have actually more severe disease and actually have a longer duration of infection. This was something that has been already seen in other data where they analyzed much higher number of patients. But then when we start to look at the kinetics of antibody response that you can see here, again, I want to show you here the red line represent the, let's say, kinetics of the antibodies, in this case, the virus neutralizing antibodies, and the red lines represent the patients with severe disease. And you can see by yourself that the patients with severe disease were the one, at least these two, that definitely were the one that were reaching, I would say, a higher titer much faster than the other. Many of the patients that have very mild disease, they actually have low level of antibodies at the beginning. And the same was similar when we measure the IgG or even IgM, even if I don't test it, I'm not showing here, the antibodies specific for the RBD part of spike, the spike proteins together, and the nucleoprotein. Briefly, we noticed one point that actually if the first, we look at the first detectable antibody response, and if the first detectable antibody response was actually a response against nucleoproteins, this we found this sort of pattern in the patients that have severe disease. In the patients that instead have mild moderate disease, the first antibody that was appearing in the serum of this patient were mainly, and you can see it here, patients that have really mild symptoms. And when we can see the nucleoprotein antibody in also the patients that have mild symptoms, still there was a large quantity of anti-spike antibody. So somehow here, what we want to say is that the severe symptoms were associated with a sort of dominant anti-nucleoprotein antibody response. And there have been a paper now recently that came out in Immunity. I want to stress that this is not only our observation, that have observed exactly the same pattern of antibody response. But now let's go to the T cells. So these are SARS-CoV-2 T cells, the complete, T cells that are responding to all these different proteins. Here we just make a sort of, addition of all the different T cells that we found in the patients during the initial phase here represented in this sort of, pink background. And the green background represents instead the test that was done, after 2-3 months from the acute infection. And you can see from yourself that actually the subjects that have mild and moderate disease, they were actually the one that have a stronger T cell response. I would say in this case, an interferon gamma ELISpot assay that was much, much more robust than what we found in the patients with severe disease. And actually, this patient is actually the one that actually, again, die, and he has basically a very small response here that is you barely see because it's practically at the level of zero, but you have a very minimal response only to spike proteins. And again, here are the same data where we show that basically the high quantity of interferon gamma T cells is really associated with mild disease, even when we count in the number of cells at different times after the onset of symptoms. And when we were looking at the time of the T cell appearance and the duration of infection, we can see that actually the time of T cell appearance, so basically when we were able to detect it, the T cell response in this subject, it was correlated with the short duration of infection. Here is the day from a symptom of onset. When we got the T cells, they were really early. We actually have the subject that were really clearing the infection early. And such observation was not done in subjects that when we were looking at antibodies. I want also to show this slide here. I will spend a little bit more time because it's a complicated slide. Basically, all this bar represent, again, the level of T cell response that we found. These are the patients with mild, moderate disease. These on the left are the three patients with severe disease. And again, the different color represent the T cell response specific for the different proteins of SARS-CoV-2. And I think you can see by yourself that actually during the early phases of the infection, the first T cells that we were able to detect in these patients, in the patients with moderate disease, they were actually specific for ORF7-8 and ORF3-8. And this response actually was not detectable anymore at the convalescent phase and was really low in this subject. Why is that? Why we can see this sort of dominance of the response against ORF7-8 or ORF3? It's honestly something that I don't know. I might say that in some healthy individuals in Singapore, at least in Asia, we can find some level of response against this ORF7 in subjects that apparently were not infected. So, but that's what, it's an observation that I think we need really to analyze better and understand. And in this slide, I just show you that again, if I'm measuring, for example, the quantity of ORF7 and ORF8 specific T cells during the acute phase, they represent about 15-20% of the total T cell response, but then basically they became lower than 10%. And something that is not happening for nucleoprotein or for membrane or for spike, but you can see some are going down, but most of them are going up. So therefore, I mean, here, what I just want to say is that the contribution of T cells specific for different viral proteins seems to actually change over time. And therefore the hierarchy of SARS-CoV-2 T cells seems to be different in the memory phase. And is an observation that I think is interesting. The conclusion about this first part of the talk is therefore that the quantity of virus-specific antibodies seems to correlate with COVID-19 severity. This is not an observation that is new. There are now a lot of data around showing that there is this correlation with quantity of antibody and severity of a disease. We found that there was a dominant and early induction of anti-NP antibody was occurring before spike in the subject with severe disease. And then when we look at the quantity of virus-specific T cells, we can see that it's associated with mild disease. And the early induction of SARS-CoV-2-specific T cells seems actually to induce and accelerate viral clearance. Therefore, I mean, somehow this data, even though clearly there are very few subjects that we have analyzed, they are really saying that probably, I mean, showing that again, the T cell seems to be really important, a real contribution for the control of SARS-CoV-2 infection. And perhaps even that the early presence of SARS-CoV-2 T cell can be thought as a sort of diagnostic to try to understand whether a subject that is infected is not going to develop a severe disease. Okay, I think I have other 10 minutes, am I right?
Yes.
I think I will try. 7 or 8 minutes. Yeah, I will try to just tell you a little bit about some new work that we have done in asymptomatic subjects. I will go a little bit perhaps faster, but again, here the question was, what's happening in the complete asymptomatic subject? Are T cells induced in subjects that are really not having any symptoms? What is the frequency? Is the frequency similar to the subject that instead are developing disease? And whether they are targeting the same viral proteins and whether they differ in function. And this slide, I just want to say that in Singapore, we have basically an infection, a quantity of infected people that was really extremely high in this foreign workers' dormitory, where basically foreign workers that are coming to Singapore to live, they are living in these compounds. And basically at the beginning, particularly in March, April, they were not really followed up very well. And we have a real high quantity of infection. So we decided to study this subject that are mainly young people, 25, 35 years old, and they are fine. They were completely asymptomatic, most of them. And we study them taking samples at three different time points, basically at time points about around May, then after 2 weeks, and then after 6 weeks. And we measure initially only the serology, but here at the last time points, we study T cell response. So again, here is just to say that we invited 500 patients pretty much, and most of them, you can see it here, 90%, they were really no symptom at all. And we didn't study the patients that have symptoms, we really concentrated only in the subjects that were without symptoms, and we were able to study T cell response in 85 of them. Here is just to show that there was infection that was going on, because this represents basically the presence of antibody against NP and the virus neutralizing antibody at the time of the recruitment, after 2 weeks, and then after 6 weeks of follow-up. You can see it better here, probably on the left of the slides. You can see that the quantity of subjects that actually became antibody positive was going up, reaching about 60% of the subjects that we tested, and they were all asymptomatic in this dormitory. So based on this, we can see actually that there were sort of, let's say, three different patterns of antibody response. The subject that have already antibody at the first time points, and they remain pretty much with antibody positive. There were the subjects that instead were negative at week zero of the first time points, but then became positive after 2 weeks. And there were subjects that were consistently negative and became positive only at 6 weeks. And why we thought that this was interesting? Well, because we thought that in this case, we can actually study the T cell response in asymptomatic patients, knowing that, for example, in this group, likely the infection was happening within 1 month. It's always difficult to understand when a complete asymptomatic subject has been infected, because being asymptomatic means that it does not know, and you just find the antibodies. But in this case, we were able basically to group the patients in different groups that were probably infected at least two months before our test, but subjects that were likely instead infected only 2-3 weeks before our test. And basically, they were negative and they became positive at the last time points. Now I want to show you the data here. And we tested the T cell response against spike, membrane, and nucleoprotein. And you can see by yourself immediately that first, all the asymptomatic subjects basically were able to mount a good T cell response that was able to recognize spike, membrane, and nucleoprotein. The frequency of the T cells was a little bit higher in the subjects that were infected, probably, I would say, have a sort of recent infection, okay? The one that became positive for antibody only at the last time points. When we compare this with our asymptomatic COVID-19, this again, subject that had the disease but were recovered, we can see that the pattern of response was pretty much, I would say, identical. You can see it by yourself. And these are, I would say, our control of completely unexposed healthy individual. You can see sometimes we find few responses, but most of the time they are negative. But you can see it here that the pattern was pretty much identical. And when we were looking basically at the kinetics of the, I would say, memory response and the quantity, the magnitude of the T cell response during the acute phase or during, let's say, first months after the infection. In the COVID-19, this was the sort of the level that we found, about 1,000, 2,000, some of the subjects, but some of the subjects will have this sort of response, about, let's say, 500, 300 spots. And then the frequency just go down, but it still remains. You can see this, we have already also subjects that were studied of COVID-19 7 months ago, the response was present. And in the asymptomatic, I would say that we find exactly the same pattern. Particularly, we were extremely interested to see that completely asymptomatic patients that were infected probably recently, they reach a level of T cell response that is pretty much identical to what we found in the symptomatic subject. And finally, this is my last slide, that actually we start also to study the cytokines produced by the T cells in the supernatant. So at the moment, we have done only this assay. And you can see it here that the asymptomatic actually seems to have a much higher level of interferon gamma production on in relation to the number of T cells. Here, probably you can see better here, this is the quantity of interferon gamma that we found in the supernatant of our T cells. And you can see that actually the quantity of interferon and interleukin-2 is actually higher in asymptomatic than in the symptomatic subject. Therefore, again, I think I'm finishing with these slides. Our conclusion is SARS-CoV-2 specific T cells are absolutely induced in completely asymptomatic case of SARS-CoV-2 infection. The frequency is similar to patients with COVID-19 symptoms, targeting similar viral proteins. Frequency declines over time, but seems similar to what is we can see in symptomatic cases. And they produce actually higher level of interferon gamma. Therefore, I would say that the general idea that asymptomatic individuals do not mount a good T cell response, we don't think is correct. I think actually the asymptomatic individual, they are probably asymptomatic because they are able really to mount a very robust antigen-specific T cell response. And I'm gonna finish this and I will be happy to get some question. This is a photo of the lab when we were still able to have some sort of, let's say, gathering, civilized gathering. And thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you, Antonio, for a terrific talk. The talk is now open for questions. There's one from Adrian Hayday, our next speaker, and the question is, the suggestion that T cell responses are worse in those more severely affected might reflect severity-related cytopenia. Do you think that is the case? Might virus-specific T cells be selectively lost? Second question.
It could definitely be. I would say that Adrian is right. I mean, one, I would say the limitation of our study is one, that we study the T cells only with a single assay, that is interferon gamma L spot. And it could be that, you know, the severe patients have initially a T cell response that is getting completely deleted and we are not able to see. What I'm much more interested in a way is to say, well, look, guys, if we are studying the patients and we found a good response, it's likely that these patients are going to control. I would say that our data in terms of pathogenesis of the severity are too weak, no question. I really don't know what's happening in the severe. What I can say is that I cannot find such cells. It could be because they were induced and then deleted, yes, or they are completely exhausted. That's a whole possibility that we need to study. But Adrian is right.
Other questions? Okay,
I could ask one.
We have two people who've raised their hands also, but go ahead, Steve.
Okay, so I guess one of the take-home messages I was getting, tell me if this is true, is that the severe cases often have very early and strong antibody response, but no T or weak T cell response. And so I guess this is saying that a very high titer of antibodies is not enough. It's not doing the trick for these severe cases. Without the T cell response, they still get very, very sick, even with that high antibody.
Without a functional T cells that are producing gamma, apparently, yes. But again, this is going back to a little bit the previous question. How I can be completely sure that there was no induction in this subject? I'm not sure. What I can tell you is that if I'm studying patients longitudinally during the early phase of infection, and these patients then develop severe disease, I can find antibody, large quantity, but probably because also the viral antigen is there, is maintained, is producing large quantity, and therefore the antibody are continuously produced. I'm not thinking that, you know, this doesn't demonstrate that the antibody are causing severity, not at all. I'm just saying that there is this association. And instead, if I found immediately some T cells within the first week after the symptoms, well, most of the patients are going to control.
Yeah, and those antibodies are not adequate on their own to neutralize the virus, apparently.
No, probably not. I mean, this is something that, to be honest, I mean, the animal model of SARS-CoV-2, and I will say, I mean, this is my ignorance. I'm not really an expert of this virus, and therefore I don't know how much, you know, the animal model are really representative. But I was reading, they seem pretty representative of what's happening. And to be honest, in the animal model, I mean, the T cells are extremely important.
Rodney Rothstein, you're unmuted. You can ask a question.
Yes, thank you for a great talk. I want to ask a question about whether you think that people who were pre-exposed to different SARS, not SARS-CoV-2, but to a different coronavirus, could possibly have already the T cells, and so that could be some of the differences that you're seeing.
My only answer is, do I think it's possible? Yes, I think it's possible. It's something that I am interested in. Our first, work, we were basically saying, look, if we are looking at healthy individuals, we can find that about 50% of the subjects that I'm testing here in Singapore, I can find some T cells. Usually not a very broad repertoire, mainly one, two, let's say T cells that are able to recognize only one antigen, but these cells were there. Are these T cells sufficient? Clearly, I don't know. What we found that I found interested in these early phases is this dominance of this ORF7-8 response. So these are two proteins, and actually what is even interesting, is more interesting, and in Singapore, we can see that the subjects that are actually mild disease, they often develop a SARS virus with a deletion of ORF8. So maybe that response is that might be present because there was some other coronavirus before, I don't know. They might actually sort of, let's say, exert a pressure on the virus that then when it basically lose the ORF8, it became less pathogenic. Something that has been seen already in SARS, actually, because in SARS it was the same. The SARS virus, when it became less pathogenic, lost this region that is similar to ORF8.
So we have time for one more very quick question from David Cohen.
Yeah, thank you for this very interesting presentation. Since T-cell help is presumably required for antibody responses, it would seem like there's much more complexity in the T-cell response to the virus. I wonder if you'd comment on that. Thank you.
you are right. You might say, hey, the severe cases were developing a lot of antibody, and you are going to tell me that you didn't find any T-cells. What I'm saying is that I didn't find any T cells that were able to produce interferon gamma. I can tell you that, and therefore there could be the possibility that there are helper T cells that are producing other cytokines. Yes, to be completely honest, it's something that we are looking. Unfortunately, just to let you know, in Singapore, the PBMCs of the subject that were taken when they were still PCR positive can be handled only in a BSL-3. And do experiment in a BSL-3 for T-cell immunology is a nightmare. I can only do ELISpo. So I don't know, but there could be the possibility that there are helper T-cells that are induced, that are producing, for example, only IL-21, and maybe they are boosting the antibody response, but again, they do not, they have very low level of antiviral effect.